This video is brought to you by Skillshare.
What is the most exciting or some of the most exciting things that you see in the future impact of Neuralink?
At first, we'll solve a lot of brain-related diseases. There's a lot that can be done to improve quality of life of individuals.
With electrodes surgically inserted into his brain, he is able to play the game Pong simply by thinking about moving his hand up or down.
It's going to increase your bandwidth, your access to information, and you're going to be able to talk without words.
I would love one, by the way. After the first couple thousand go through, I want one.
I don't have to surgically implant. I don't have that urge. I'm sorry.
In 2016, Neuralink was launched by Elon Musk. Neuralink aims to treat paralysis, blindness, and other forms of impairments, all by transplanting brain-computer interfaces into the body. Neuralink has been in the media a lot, but there are also other companies who try to do the nearly impossible, and there already have been first successes. The question now is, how far can we go? Can we fully treat disabilities or even give every one of us superhuman-like abilities? My name's Gimmons, and today we'll see how we can use brain-computer interfaces to control devices with our minds. Our story today begins in 1924 in Germany. Hans Berger was a German scientist who was interested in understanding how conscience works. He asked himself, what does the brain actually do when we think or feel? So he tried to develop a device which could measure the activity of brains. It took a long time, but finally had a promising prototype. He only needed one opportunity to test his device. Ah, hey Hans, I have this device here. Can I use it in one of your freshly operated cancer patients? Sure, use this teenager here. Nice. With that, the electroencephalography, or EEG, was born. Suddenly, scientists could measure the activity of brain areas, but it would take years until we understood how the brain actually works. Every time we think or move, certain brain cells become active and release and shortly take up ions from the environment. This sudden movement of ions is then detectable as a change in electrical signal or potential. This doesn't happen in all parts of the brain at the same time, but only in selected regions, depending on what we do. If, for example, we move an arm, brain cells in the so-called motor cortex become active. If we experience stress, another part of the brain called amygdala responds. Of course, it's a bit more complicated, but we'll leave it here for today. Hans Berger's invention suddenly enabled scientists to measure brain activity, but it would take years until scientists realized the potential of this discovery. Got it? Potential? Like in electrical potential? Ha! Not funny? Anyway, let's continue. In the 1950s and 1960s, technology started to advance rapidly. American computer scientist Thelma Estrin was interested in the EEG. She theorized that we could connect the recordings of brain activity with computer systems. This means that every time a certain brain region becomes active, we could execute a command on a computer. So she connected an EEG to the brain of a participant and a computer. Then she observed periodic flashes on a computer screen, consistent with the brain activity of the participant. Slowly, the possibility arose that this form of technology could be used for communication. In the 1980s, scientists tried to find out whether we can use brain activity alone to communicate words. They placed participants in a room and showed them letters and numbers in a 6x6 matrix. The scientists told the participants that they should only focus on one specific letter. Then single rows or columns started to light up. The theory is that if we focus on one single letter, not much will happen as long as the letter stays dark. If this one letter lights up though, our brain will respond and we can record that response. Using this technology, participants could successfully communicate single letters or even whole words by just focusing on the displayed letters and waiting for them to light up. This is how brain-computer interfaces were born. Generally speaking, brain-computer interfaces are devices that connect a brain to a computer. We can record the activity of selected parts of the brain, and if they become active, we can create an output on a computer. The more sensitive our recordings get, the more complex the output on a computer can become. This is also why many people are now focusing on brain-computer interfaces which are directly transplanted into the head of the patient. If the device becomes sensitive enough, we could control all kinds of different things with our minds. We will now hear two different stories where brain-computer interfaces have changed the lives of patients. Over 2.2 billion people around the world have some form of impaired vision, and over 40 million people suffer from complete blindness. KH is a 25-year-old man who worked as a butcher. One day at work, he felt that his vision became worse. He didn't think too much of it, but over time the condition became worse. When he felt that he couldn't work properly anymore, he went to the doctor. The doctor started testing and soon gave him a horrific diagnosis. KH suffered from retinitis pigmentosa. This is an incurable disease where parts of the eye deteriorate over time, causing blindness. There wasn't much KH could do, and he became permanently blind. A couple of years later, KH heard of a clinical trial where people received bionic eyes. Bionic eyes are a subform of brain-computer interfaces, which consists of an electronic device and a camera. The electronic device is implanted into the eyes, and a camera transmits signals to the device. Depending on what the camera records, the electronic device stimulates the nerves of the eyes differently, and the eyes sends directly signals to the brain, which are then perceived as information. And as a result, we can bypass some forms of blindness. KH immediately signed up for the trial and was accepted. After the surgery, KH had to adjust for a while, but then he started to see something. When people ask him what he sees when he looks outside on a sunny day, he described them as flashes. Of course, he had to learn what the camera actually shows him. Using this technology though, KH and other blind patients could perceive movements and shapes. Bionic eyes have been constantly developed over the years to become more sensitive. To this date, over 300 people carry bionic eyes worldwide. But there is one major issue. Right now, classical bionic eyes can only send a couple of hundred different signals. This means that the brain only receives a limited number of information. In order to see properly, we would estimate not a couple of hundred different signals, but millions of signals. But scientists want to go a step further. In 2020, a team of researchers developed a bionic eye with extremely small wires. This makes it possible to send 50 times more different signals to the brain than a human eye. This bionic eye can also detect wavelengths, which are barely visible for humans, and people could gain night vision. So since this bionic eye has been quite new, there have not been clinical trials yet, but it will start soon. Oh, what's that? Unlimited knowledge? Yes, my friend, and with that, welcome to today's sponsor, Skillshare. Skillshare is a community of creative and curious people. Using Skillshare, you can learn everything from time management to personal branding or video marketing. I specifically want to balance my PhD work and my YouTube videos. So I've recently joined the Productivity Today class by Kevin Siska. He's just wonderful in helping me to decrease my online distraction and prioritize the right tasks. This class was especially useful as it taught me to create separate lists for all my video ideas or planned experiments. I now saw the importance of all the bullet points I created. I'm now looking forward to the Productivity Masterclass by Ali Abdal to expand my knowledge in productivity. And like me, he also could help you, so join today. The first 1000 people to use this link will get a 1 month free trial on Skillshare. So what are you waiting for? Join the Skillshare community today. Where were we? Oh yeah, controlling robotic arms. Esti is a 33-year-old woman who has always lived a healthy life. She liked jogging, hiking, or just go for a walk outside. One day on her way home from work though, she started to feel dizzy. She couldn't breathe properly and her vision became worse. She went to the doctor's office where they called an ambulance and she was taken to the emergency room. There the doctor suspected that Esti had a stroke and they stabilized her. When they conducted tests, they found that she had a stroke in the brainstem. The brainstem is found in the bottom of the brain and it is responsible for regulating balance, breathing and heart rate. In ST's case, the blood flow in the brainstem was blocked, leading to an undersupply of the region. This is life-threatening, and so the doctors did everything they could to treat ST. And although she survived, she soon lost the ability to speak or move her arms or legs. Unfortunately, she had to accept her fate. Over 10 years after the incidents, she heard of a clinical trial where scientists implant brain-computer interfaces to move robotic arms. So she applied, and she and another patient were accepted. The goal was to transplant a device called brain gate into the motor cortex of the brain. The motor cortex is a part of the brain which is responsible for our movement. Although stroke patients are often paralyzed, the motor cortex is still intact. The transplanted device is then connected to a robotic arm. If the patient imagines to move a limb, the motor cortex will become active and the robotic arm moves. And astonishingly, using this technology, both patients were able to move a robotic arm. They could reach for objects and even move a straw in order to drink something. A couple of years later, the same research team transplanted an advanced version of the device into the motor cortex of patients. This time though, they transplanted another device into their muscles. Similar to before, the device records the activity of the motor cortex. But instead of transmitting a signal to a robotic arm though, the signal is directly sent to the device's inner muscles. This then stimulates the muscles, making them move. Using this device, the paralyzed patients could with some assistance use their arms and eat food. Although I have to say that these movements are still restricted, there is a high chance that one day this technology might help paralyzed patients to move again. Besides focusing on mobility, scientists also try to give completely paralyzed patients back their speech. In 2022, scientists used a computer brain interface transplant on a completely paralyzed patient. The scientists transplanted the device into the motor cortex of the patient. The goal was to transmit signals between the motor cortex and external device, which can formulate sentences. Of course, the patient didn't know how to use his motor cortex like that. So after transplantation, the scientist turned on a speaker, which gives a specific tone when his cortex is active. In this manner, the patient learned to control the sound of the speaker and over time learned to control the device. When he then switched to spelling letters, he spelled, "Boys, it works effortlessly." And this was the first time a completely paralyzed patient could formulate whole sentences using only his mind. And here is also where Neuralink comes into play. Neuralink aims to develop technologies which help to control devices with your mind. And although Neuralink has not started clinical trials yet, they have some preliminary data. In 2021, the company transplanted a brain-computer interface into the brain of a monkey. The device then recorded which brain regions become active when the monkey moved the controller up, down, or sideways. After the device has understood which precise regions in the brain become active with which movement, the researchers unplugged the controller. The monkey still tried to use the unplugged controller and the same brain regions became active. But this time though, the device sent the signals directly to the screen, meaning that the monkey could play the game with its mind. So with this, there are some implications. One day we might be able to give back patients their ability to move, speak, or see. But the question is, will we stop there? Because once technology has advanced far enough, we can potentially use all different kinds of devices with our minds. And this could include cars, phones, or even the metaverse. Oh god. We could also control our bodies better, gain a better sight, or even become stronger. So again, the question is, how far can we go and what do we even want? In the last century, we've witnessed the rise of science and technology. We started to understand how the brain works and what happens if we use our minds. At the same time, more and more powerful computers have been developed. Now it seems that neuroscience and computer science can come together not to only alleviate diseases such as paralysis or blindness, but also enhance the capability of humans. With that, a question to you, what's your opinion on this technology? And would you accept such a transplant to gain better abilities? With that, I hope that you enjoyed this video, and if so, feel free to like it and comment about your opinion on this topic or comment something randomly. I mean, you can do what you want. And with that, I'll see ya. If you're interested in how to get smarter or how scientists try to slow down aging, you might like these videos.